One of the more terrifying concepts in science fiction is the idea that some kind of extraterrestrial contaminant, a microorganism or virus analog of alien origin, could somehow be delivered to Earth and then move on to infect life here. The most famous example of this within science fiction is perhaps Michael Crichton's 1969 novel, The Andromeda Strain. But this concept is also deeply rooted in human history, where different groups of people coming into contact with each other caught diseases for which one group had immunity and the other did not. But there is an important distinction to make there. Those incidences, which still happen today when uncontacted or isolated tribes of humans come into contact with our global civilization, happen because we're all still Homo sapiens and are genetically very similar across the entire species. This opens us all up to human viruses, yet the overwhelming vast majority of viruses that exist on Earth do not infect humans. The reason for this ultimately is that viruses are very specialized in just what they can do on a chemical and biological basis. You can have them jump species to a degree, but only rarely and very situationally. As a result, if alien viruses exist, and there's no guarantee of that, they are likely to be specialized to an alien biosphere and its genomes. Assuming panspermia exists and something like a virus can survive the conditions of interstellar space, or for that matter, interplanetary space, then Earth is no stranger to alien viruses. They have likely been deposited here before, and there is no evidence that anything on this planet has ever been infected by one. Or for that matter, there is no evidence that such a thing has ever landed here contained within a meteorite. But even if it did, it might not last long in this environment and may never find a way to replicate. If that's the case, we'd never come across it. There have been in the past some fringe hypotheses that all viruses originate from outer space, but this has not been borne out. Rather, viruses appear to have co-evolved with life on Earth from the very start, and may have played a role in the early evolution of microbial life on this world. It's even conceivable that this could represent a solution to the Fermi paradox, that solution being that worlds that do not have pressure from viruses do not produce life above the microbial level, in which case we live in a universe of microbes without viruses, and only here did we get lucky by having both an abiogenesis of life, but also an abiogenesis of sorts for viruses. If you get one without the other, the magic simply doesn't happen. On the other hand, there is also the direct contact scenario, where the aliens land on the White House lawn, and some extraterrestrial pathogen is transmitted to us, or we transmit something to the aliens, War of the Worlds style. This too is unlikely. First, you'd need basic commonality in biochemistry. There's no guarantee an alien could breathe our atmosphere, for example. Most likely, they could not directly do so, thus would need to isolate themselves in their equivalent of a spacesuit. They'd also likely know of any risk biologically, being advanced enough to travel the vast distances of space, and would take measures to prevent cross-contamination of biospheres. In fact, alien life may be so different that they don't even function solely on water, but rather incorporate ammonia as a solvent for the chemistry of life. Could an ammonia-based organism live long in the environment of Earth? That seems unlikely. So some kind of isolation would be key in an actual direct first contact scenario. Another option is that aliens are super immune to everything by virtue of their technology. In principle, it may be possible to create an artificial immune system, impervious to everything using nanotechnology and advanced biotechnology. It may even be that viruses on worlds eventually go extinct through technological development. We already do this to a certain degree. We have nearly eradicated or mitigated some former scourges of humanity, such as the Black Death or smallpox. Malaria has been controlled in some areas of the world where it used to be a serious problem, and polio is likewise mitigated to the point that it's now rare, whereas decades ago it was far from it. This trend will continue for us as we gain greater control over infectious disease. We're obviously not there yet, but there may be a day where infectious disease no longer occurs, and that may be the case for alien species, and they may in fact be so superimmune that nothing on this Earth can infect them, whether virus or microbe, and they can't carry anything here from their planet of origin. and that could be an infection in and of itself. If you come across an alien, say in deep space, and you find some way to interact directly or come into contact with nanotechnological contamination, even from a long-dead spacecraft you might run across, you could end up with alien superimmunity without even realizing it was happening. It might be that generalized nanotech is somehow compatible with you on a technological rather than biological basis, and it starts changing your DNA for immunity. If so, you have just come across an entirely new class of malady, nanotechnological illness, and it may be far easier for technology to infect in a generalized manner than biology can pull off. It could even get confused and eradicate your intestinal bacteria, resulting in death. And it gets worse. If you were to encounter a covert alien civilization that hides itself from you while it studies your planet, it could in principle engineer viruses or nanotech to infect you for whatever purpose they want. This is something we do. Biological weapons are one side of this, but there is another, and it involves the viruses again. One of the most exciting areas of medical research today is the idea of altering viruses to cure disease. This started with vaccines and weakened viruses, but this research stems from a rather curious observation from over 100 years ago, during the 1918 Spanish flu pandemic. Doctors noticed that people that had cancer that caught and survived the influenza outbreak sometimes showed that their tumors temporarily shrank, and their overall condition improved for a time. These curious observations were sidelined due to the lack of understanding of genetics and viruses, and the treatment direction went towards surgery and chemotherapy, but the idea was not entirely forgotten. In recent years, a new avenue of cancer treatment has been developing, virotherapy, where altered viruses are used to target and kill cancer cells directly, or better yet, provoke the immune system into a response against the cancer, opening the way for a potentially complete cure or very effective treatment in freezing the progress of the disease. One way of doing this is to have the virus deposit a chemical marker on the cancerous cells that the immune system recognizes and then goes on the attack. This therapy is already being used for cancers such as melanoma, and shows further great promise in many areas of oncology. But back to the question of alien life. Close aliens may know of this kind of technology as well, and might use pathogens engineered specifically for the lesser technologically advanced species they've come across to do good or ill, depending on their aim. Again, there's no evidence of this ever having happened here. Our diseases look fully natural and Earth-like, and if something were here, it probably would have acted dramatically long before now. But the idea, in principle, is plausible. As an aside, we could do the same thing, again in principle. Say for a moment we found that Proxima B was habitable but not inhabited by any kind of life. One way of tweaking and terraforming a world long term is molecular nanotechnology. You essentially infect a potentially suitable world for colonization with nanotech, perhaps aided by specialized viruses, and then program it to develop habitability, and then come back in 10,000 years to another Earth ready for human habitation. Perhaps one function of viruses in this case might serve as a preventative for natural abiogenesis on auto-terraformed worlds. And therein lies a rather creepy solution to the Fermi paradox. This one is more of a subset of a proposed solution rather than a new solution in and of itself. The core idea here is that we're early in the game as far as life in the Milky Way, and it's generally still rare. But what also must be taken into account is that if we are early, there could easily be an even earlier civilization that is a billion or 2 years on us. They would be from a time, however, when civilization might have been so rare that early on that they might be the only example. And the reason we don't see them is that they are simply discreet, but in overall control of the galaxy at large. They might have chosen to leave us alone, having discovered our world long before we arose, but still harboring early life. The very fact that life exists on an exoplanet may dictate what that ancient civilization does with a world. If it finds life, it leaves that planet alone to its own devices to see what comes of it. But if suitable worlds are found that have not yet developed life, the ancient civilization may simply put them on ice and prevent life from arising there with the eventual intent of using those exoplanets to their own end. Perhaps they might move from one planet to the next, exhausting its resources and then moving on to the next candidate, all while leaving inhabited planets alone. In such a scenario, is that the reason for the Great Silence is that most suitable exoplanets for life are being artificially prevented from developing it? This could lead us to great mystery as we explore and characterize exoplanets. If we see perfectly suitable worlds for life, but seemingly without it, then we'd have to ask the question, are we seeing a technosignature of worlds on ice? Or is abiogenesis really that rare and difficult? Without cracking abiogenesis in the lab, that could be a question that we wonder about for decades. And if abiogenesis does turn out to be relatively easy and straightforward, we'd have to consider that there is some kind of galactic governor on it. And that's all we may ever know about alien life in the galaxy, that it governs abiogenesis for some reason, but ignores us and other previous occurrences of life entirely. Returning to viruses, all of this assumes that we know everything there is to know about the possibility of viruses. We clearly do not. And within the depths of speculative astrobiology lies one of the spookiest possibilities out there, generalized viruses. It's possible that viruses on planet Earth have it easy, and thus can afford to be highly specialized and targeted. Earth is a smorgasbord that allows them to get by easily. But what of a dying world? In a situation like Mars, it may be very different. Think about it. Where a planet very slowly loses its ability to host surface liquid water, and thus easy life, might desperate viruses, if life had arisen there, become increasingly resilient and generalized in order to infect any cell they possibly could to keep going? Ultimately, we don't know, but one recent finding might shed some light on this issue. It's in regards to a bacterium that I've covered on this channel before, the astonishingly radiation-resistant species Deinococcus radiodurans, also known as Conan the Bacterium, which can survive roughly 28,000 times more radiation than a human. In a paper by William Horne and colleagues, link in the description below, they found that one of the reasons this bacterium is so resistant to radiation is that it has evolved the ability to dry out and accumulate protective antioxidant manganese compounds, along with unique genetic repair systems, and that radiation resistance was favored by that. But in this case, the researchers envisioned whether this bacterium could survive on Mars and how long it could remain dried out but still revivable. The answer is astonishing. Yes, it could survive indefinitely in a frozen and desiccated state just 10 meters below the surface of Mars, and it could do it for about 280 million years. At the same time, it would not fare anywhere near as well on the surface, only a few hours, probably eliminating the possibility of panspermia from Earth. The question is, can a generalized virus remain dormant on Mars in the same way? If so, it would need to be able to do it far longer than 280 million years to get back to the time when Mars had liquid water several billion years ago. But with periodic melting due to volcanism and impacts, it may in principle be possible for bacteria and their potential accompanying viruses to have survived on Mars and could be waiting for us. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently concerned about panspermic Conan the Bacterium. One of them long ago was busy absorbing something, and along comes an asteroid impact, flinging it to Mars. It gets there and it's like, well, I guess I'll just dry out and wait until somebody picks me up. And along comes a manned Mars mission 100 million years later. Not good, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.